Now we want some practices to do in order to be able to bring our spiritual life into our everyday life. We tend to get bogged in by our problems. We tend to lose the consciousness of the higher dimensions of our being. You might find it very difficult to do all the practices we did. There's one practice that we can do that will help us make spirituality a reality. And that is to, as I said before, you discover yourself in another yourself who's better able to be what you are yourself. And what is more, one can always enter into the consciousness of any being in the universe. So come with me on a pilgrimage to the Himalayas, and you find yourself in a enchanted kind of landscape. You feel a very strong presence, and truly enough, there is a great rishi sitting in the mountain fastness. Now, as it is a custom, you greet him and you sit in his presence. And if he's a great rishi, he will not be speaking to you. He'll look into your eyes, and maybe he'll close his eyes. Maybe again he'll open his eyes. And there you are, watching his being. And the first thing you notice is that he seems to be exuding a very powerful atmosphere, a sort of magnetic atmosphere. Even the trees around him seem to be full of his presence. As you sit there, you begin to become aware of your magnetism. You experience in yourself what you witness in him. If you observe him further, you will notice that he seems to have the power of a king. Sovereignty, power. And yet, on the other hand, he may be egoless. And when you feel this, you become aware of this power and this majesty, you begin to feel it in yourself. Of course, it's obvious that he has overcome himself. You don't know exactly how. You see him here sitting in the sunshine. But maybe you don't know that he has been sitting through the night in the snow and the ice. And maybe you don't know that he has been fasting for months. And maybe you don't know what a struggle it was for him to extirpate himself from his life. And somehow he has mastered himself, and consequently he is free . And you notice that because he looks as though he was surrounded by a zone of silence. Nothing could affect him. And as you see this, you yourself begin to feel free. His freedom has freed you. And you also begin to feel the power that comes when one has been able to take control of oneself. And there you sit, forgetting who you are and experiencing his being in your being. And now when you look into his eyes, you see there's just so much light. And as a matter of fact, you might even be aware of the aura he radiates. It's just like looking into the sun, but a much more subtle sun that is sending its glow upon you. And your whole being is lit up by his light. Could be her, it doesn't have to be he. And you are just full of light. And this triggers off, as we've already seen, the memory of all your passage through the angelic planes. And when you look in him further, you see that he seems so happy, and yet at the same time, he's very peaceful. And if you look further into his eyes, you will see that despite this happiness, there's a lot of pain. His consciousness is reaching out into the vastness. And he's aware of the terrible sufferings of humans, people in concentration camps, and people dying of hunger and epidemics. And so how can he sit there simply in a state of joy? There's both. There's joy and there's suffering, and there's even peace beyond the joy. And his whole being seems to be so alive with emotion, it's very difficult to say what it is. There's ecstasy too. And so you are moved to the very core of your being. It's like all the joys and the pain and all the jubilation and the despair and all the intoxication and the sobriety felt by all creatures is here present, living. The whole drama of life. And yet he is sitting here, remote, far away from the crowds. And so your soul goes through the most incredible states. Twisted and torn and healed and rejoicing and yet at the same time peaceful. You go through all his states. And you realize that they are cosmic states. Like it's not his pain, but it's the pain of humanity. His heart is like a parcel of the heart of the Veiled One, the Mother of the World, who feels the pain in her children. And you're experiencing also the jubilations, the victory in the heavens, because he's not just sitting here on the planet, he's experiencing the condition of the universe at all levels. The great drama enacted behind the drama of the world. In comparison, your little upsets and your little pleasures and your little thrills appear so insignificant in facing the enormous dimensions of the emotion of this being. You remember the words of Hazrat Inayat Khan, you place your finger on the pulse of the universe. So emotion becomes cosmic. Despite all of this very intense emotion, somewhere his soul is in a state of bliss and serenity, and suddenly you discover that even though you might be suffering intensely for some reason that is beyond your person, you can still, part of your being can still be in a state of perfect serenity and peace. If you were just in your own consciousness, you would probably be in a turmoil and you would be able to reconcile all these intense emotions. But here, his sublime attunement overcomes all upsets. And the reason for that is, of course, that he has become free in himself. So you're experiencing him in yourself. in fact, you don't even have to sit there any longer. Wherever you go, you'll find him in yourself. All the things that you saw in him, you have experienced in yourself. As a matter of fact, you would not have been able to imagine him if he wasn't yourself. You had to, after having gone to see him, you realize, as Buddha said, that there's a place that one cannot reach by going anywhere, that in fact you didn't have to go to see him because he was already in you. But nevertheless, it was by seeing him that you were able to discover yourself. That is your true being. Your real being. You have come to face with your real being. It was easier to let somebody else do it. We don't have the courage to be our real selves. Now, if you look at your problems while you're in that state of consciousness, what do you see? First of all, you see that you had been losing your magnetism. And therefore, you were losing the very power with which one can handle situations. And so, you had to first withdraw from situations in order to rebuild your magnetism, and then you have to learn how to preserve your magnetism from being depleted, and that is by always being conscious of the source of magnetism. And therefore you're continually replenishing it, as always being connected. As soon as you disconnect yourself with the source, like you simply identify with your person, then of course you lose your magnetism. You remember the practices that we did this morning, like being conscious of the earth field and the celestial field. That's the way in which we were able to rebuild our magnetism. So, if ever you feel that you're losing your magnetism, then maybe you'll have to withdraw for a moment and connect up with the source of energy. Breathing practices or whatever. The other thing is knowing how people are robbing you of your magnetism. As I said about your having a cup of tea with someone, you lose your magnetism. It's too late if you realize it afterwards. The thing is, when you start taking your cup of tea and you see your magnetism beginning to dwindle, that's the time to do something about it. One thing is, of course, it is surrounding oneself with a zone of silence so that people can't grab you and eat you up. It's something that you find amongst the sannyasins in India, it's very, I think it's a typical Oriental thing. The European, I think, or the Westerner tends to be more open and therefore exposed to all kinds of impressions and things, whereas the sannyasin particularly is, you know, he has his blanket on his shoulder and he's kind of wrapped up in his a kind of protective shield. How it doesn't, now you could say, well, isn't that refusing life and isn't it refusing compassion to people? Well, you have this very beautiful picture of Buddha being so totally aloof and yet so full of compassion. Now, of course, Christ actually went and became the guest of the publicans, and well, his attitude was much more European, one could say. He went into the whole much more Western. He went into the life, exposing himself to the injuries, the insults, and so on. But then look at Christ at, when he was captured by the Romans. You don't imagine him cringing, and yet he was being insulted and spat at. So there must be some protection there. It's a protection. If one is free in oneself, then nobody can grasp one. That's the protection, is freedom. So you're having your cup of tea, and that person is pouring his emotions on you and trying to draw you into his emotional trip. And you may be full of compassion, and yet you do not allow yourself to be drawn into that trip, because if you do, you'll never be able to help that person. That's the story of Parsifal. He couldn't help Kundry unless he could only help her by refusing to go along with her trip. It's awareness, of course, but not just awareness, an attitude of detachment. Now, you remember I said you can love very intensely and yet not depend upon being loved. That's your protection, that's your freedom. If you depend upon being loved, you are precarious, and if things go wrong, you will break down. And in fact, that's what happens. One does break down because one is precarious. It never lasts very long. And so there's only one thing to do in the beginning, is to experience that freedom of the sannyasin and always keep that freedom throughout your life. Of course, it means that if everything breaks down, you are not shattered, and if you are successful, you're not jubilant, it never goes to your head, nothing can affect you, and yet you are so terribly sensitive to the sufferings of people. but insensitive to your own suffering. That's what it is. And that explains the sovereignty of that rishi. That's why he's a king. And he gives an impression of power. That's the secret. Well, you have experienced this power now through his being. And once more you realize that when you look back upon your problems, you realize that what you were doing was you were using your power to counter the power of another person who was trying to do you harm. And then that person was getting the best of you, the better of you, because, well, he was drawing you into his battlefield and you weren't able to, you know, hit below the belt, and he didn't have any scruple about it, and so you were getting kind of desperate and very worried that your family might suffer from it, and so on and so forth. You lost the handle. So you come back and imagine that you're sitting in the presence of the rishi. Now, what does he do? Well, he is continually drawing his power from the divine power. That is, he is conscious of the divine power. Now, if you're fighting your battle and you lose consciousness of the divine power, then your power is very soon overcome, defeated. I remember when things were difficult and people were of little faith and said to Hazrat Inayat Khan, well, this situation is bad, and he said, and then he would say, it will come right with the power of God, it will come right. Of course, I was a child then. And later on I thought, well, the power of God, but then things do go wrong. And he said it will go right by the power of God. And it's taken me all this time to realize that what he meant was that it will be all right if you do if you are conscious of the power of God working through you, then things will be all right. It means you have to do something. You have to become aware of the divine power working through you. You remember at the symposium when I was asked, what is Sufism? And I said, it's that which makes things happen. Well, this is what it is. The power of the dervish makes things happen because it's not his will. He is letting a greater power come through. And now if you look at your problems, or let's say we look at our problems, then we'll see that we tend to fight alone. We tend to forget the power, the divine power, when we're in the battle. You saw that when we were repeating Kader, how different it was when we were saying it with that, with the consciousness of the divine power, or then we conscious of, we're conscious of Abraham, or we're conscious of the dervish. We identified with the dervish, we identified with the king. And then it wasn't our personal power that was acting, it was this large dimension of power that was coming through. Well, now that's a secret. Great secret. The other thing is that we suffer a guilt complex of feeling that we have not fulfilled our spiritual ideal in our lives. You ask yourselves, why are we not all dancing with joy? Why? What's the matter with us? Well, things are difficult and so on and so forth. Of course, I mean, things don't happen the way we wanted. That it would be terrible if things happened the way we wanted it. In fact, as I say, you realize how good it is that things didn't happen the way you wanted several years ago. So that's an excuse. But in the depth of our being, there's dissatisfaction with ourselves. That is the greatest despair in the soul of people, is a sense of having failed. One had all these hopes when one is younger, and here one is getting on, and one looks at oneself and thinks, well, it's very disappointing. And one doesn't know how to correct it. It seems like one has got into a certain rut, and, well, what can one do about it? Well, of course, as I said before, you are free. There is nothing that you cannot do, but you have to do it. And perhaps one of the most inspiring things, you see, we speak about the spiritual life. Well, of course, what do you mean by the spiritual life? Does it mean to be good, to do good actions? Well, of course, that's a sine qua non. Does it mean, it might mean not to let oneself be caught up in the illusions of oneself, as we saw in Buddhism, one's personal self, that's the illusion, yes, as at least it's a negative aspect, not doing something, but what is the positive aspect? Well, I think we should come back to the beginning of this retreat. If you remember what we said, what are our ideals? Realization, illumination, ecstasy, sovereignty, peace. Well, all those things that we saw in the Rishi, all of those things. In fact, the reason why we are disappointed in ourselves is because we are not that Rishi. What it means is that we are not our real selves. And in fact, we are. It's just that we don't manifest it always, and we're not conscious of it, and therefore it's not a reality in our being. So how can we do it? Well, perhaps one of the most inspiring qualities is light. I see people with a lot of light, and when I see people with a lot of light, my soul rejoices. And as a matter of fact, it brings out the light in me. There's a kind of communion of light with a person. So here we have something that we can work with. For example, when I'm talking to a person, am I radiating light? How can I radiate light? That person is so mean and is trying to force his ego upon me. How can I use light? Well, there was a tradition amongst the knights. Knighthood began in the Zoroastrian tradition. That one is only allowed to use a lance of light in one's battle. And now in Star Wars they do. It's a very winning power. They say that evil can only take place under cover of darkness. Thieves steal in the night. You come out with your light. It's a very winning, disarming power. It's not just a matter of overcoming somebody's will who's trying to do harm to one, but really establishing a deep communication with other beings. Now that's something you can work with. And to come back on what I said yesterday about meditation, a day before yesterday, which are the convenient times to practice meditation, you could. Every hour, I did it for 5 minutes, but you could even just for 1 minute, every hour, upon the hour, you could simply concentrate on light until you just be aware of being a being of light. In fact, now that you have been sitting in front of the Rishi, and now you're wandering in the Himalayas, and you're thinking about your life, and you're looking upon your problems, and then maybe you will realize that you had totally forgotten that you were a being of light. You had been so involved in your problems. And when you were walking in nature, you just thought that the world, physical world, was the way it looked. You thought, what a drab day it is today. There's a lot of fog. And how awful is this city that has been, there's so much pollution and so little good taste, and how man has spoiled nature, and so on. And so we get into this habit of just forgetting all the dimensions behind what appears on the surface. This is where we get starved of our spiritual life. And so the only thing to do then is to, when we catch ourselves thinking like this, which is all the time, so therefore plenty of time of opportunity to catch ourselves doing it, we just reflect for a moment. After all, if you're working in an office, maybe you can for a moment just close your eyes, can't you? and just think to yourself, just look at the way I've let myself be caught by this whole scene here. Well, maybe there's nothing particularly inspiring in the office, but you can find light in your being. And in fact, when you have found light in your being, you'll find light in other beings too. Because like attracts light. Light attracts light. Now, more generally, you remember that we said that perhaps the reason why the Rishi was expressed so much power, and also the reason why he was able to be so full of joy, and particularly peace, was because he was free. Now, if you watch the sannyasins, you'll find that the one rule that they follow is never to let themselves be bound. And, as a matter of fact, in India, there's this dichotomy between the sannyasin and the householder. The people who are dedicated to the spiritual life are supposed to be following the celibate life and be not be involved in any form of material earning or work of any kind. And the householder is supposed to work and to provide for his family and so on, and may partake in some way in the overglow, let's say, of the glow of the spiritual beings, but somehow it's kind of assumed that they will never reach the state of illumination or realization or beatitude. It seems that the conditions in which people are living and working do not foster the qualities that you find amongst the great rishis and the great madhubs and the prophets and the saints. And so one comes to a frightening conclusion, and that is that whatever one does, one would never be able to fulfill one's spiritual ideal. And therefore the only answer would be to retire and to live the life of an ascetic. That's a kind of thinking that one would follow. Now, I feel that the reason for this situation is because up to the present people have not been able to live up to the challenge of being able to live in the world and at the same time live their spiritual ideal. It's, I think it is true to say that as the organism progresses, it's able to do better what its predecessors were not able to do that well. That's the meaning of evolution. What does evolution mean? It simply means that as the organism progresses, he becomes more capable of doing better things that his ancestors weren't able to do that well. Now, we have a very great regard for the past, and we feel that humanity has gone backwards instead of forward. I would say, no. In the past, it was possible for beings to attain to a great spiritual height because they were able to dedicate their lives just to the spiritual life, and the householders were deprived of it. Now we're living at a time when one has to be both the sannyasin and the householder, And so the challenge is much greater. But we should be able to do today what our ancestors were not able to do before. And the curious thing is that in the New Age, culture, and, there was this assumption that there was this division. It's a modern division, no more between the sannyasin and the householder, but between the New Age person and the establishment person. That kind of thinking of division amongst people. And so the New Age person can dedicate his life to his spiritual life, but doesn't have to work and so on. And the establishment person, well, he has his style of life and so on. Well, that dichotomy is no more allowable in our time, let us say. It's the New Age is old-fashioned already. The New Age is the new era, let's say, is holistic. And what does it mean, holistic? It means that everyone, that we don't make divisions, that we're all in this together. And it means that we have to attain a kind of wholeness. That means that we must be able to incorporate the spiritual and the material at the same time. So now we have been paying a pilgrimage to the Rishi who is sitting in the mountains, and we are still wandering in the Himalayas and full of his being, and we're looking down upon our lives. And somehow we can see things better now, because in our lives we had slipped away from our spiritual ideal. Now we saw the Rishi and we got back into our spiritual ideal again. And now we're able to see both. That's the important thing. And when you look down upon your life, then you felt something of the freedom of the Rishi. And then all of a sudden you realize that what you did in your life was that you lost your freedom. That's what you realize. You realize that by involving yourself with people, you lost the most precious thing that there was. And on the other hand, you realize that you had to involve yourself with people because that's what life is all about. And now is the question, are you able to involve yourself in such a way that you engage yourself in some way and yet are able to maintain your inner freedom? There are practical problems. For example, you have a contract with a firm, and you find that that firm is doing things that you do not feel are ethical, and yet you have a contract now, and you're bound by your contract. Well, that would be a way in which one would destroy one's soul altogether by involving oneself in a way that has deprived one of one's freedom of following one's conscience. So that's a thing that one should never do, of course. Because a bad conscience, as Murshid says, turns lions into rabbits. So you have to, now comes the question, what do I mean by freedom? You see, the sannyasin enjoys some kind of freedom in that he doesn't have to clock in the morning to his office. But that kind of external freedom is not necessarily the real freedom. Not having to work or not having to provide for one's family, that's not freedom. That's simply laziness. The challenge before us is, are we able to be free inside but involved outside? That was what we saw in the sannyasin, in the rishi. It wasn't that he was able to get up when he wanted to. In fact, he doesn't. He gets up when, according to his discipline. But what we saw in him was that he was free in the sense that if we insulted him, he wouldn't be upset. That's the freedom that we are talking about, the real freedom. And so the question is, if you look back into your life, are you free in that sense? Are you free inside? That means, if things go wrong, are you able to still remain happy? Now, I think that most of us, in all honesty, would say no. No. And so if that is true, then this is where you have to work. Now, you must understand, and here understanding does play a part. I know it's not the only thing, but it does play a part. And that is, it is a matter of the value that you attach to things. If things go wrong, I said, that means that what you want doesn't happen. Well, what you want, that is what you value. You've set a value at things, and those things are you're deprived of those things, and therefore you collapse. Well, that's where what I said a minute ago is very helpful. Many years ago, you might have wanted something and it happened, and now you're sorry it happened, or you're glad that it didn't happen. In other words, you are precariously suspended upon what you value. Now, that's where your freedom has been impaired, by your placing values upon things that are passing. And so the only way to live the life of a sannyasin in the middle of life, and in other words, the only way to have that joy and that power and that peace and all those things that we admired in the rishi, the only way to do it, if you want to do it, if that's what you want, the only way to do it is by learning to be totally free, whatever your involvement. Otherwise, well then, you won't have it. And what is more, you will feel that terrible sense of failure of not having fulfilled your spiritual life. Now, this is where it's at, and we can't get around it. That's the way it is. Cutting right into the problem. We come here and we say, well, Pir Vilayat, we would like to have instructions, have some help about our spiritual life. Why did you come? Because you felt that your daily life is just, you fail to meet the most important thing. And you try to meditate and you can't concentrate, and you're hoping that I will get you into a mood that will revive your spiritual attunement, and then you'll be able to function for some time on the strength of that attunement. And I understand that. That's all of us need to have this help in getting attuned. That's why we go and visit the rishis in the Himalayas, of course. Even though we know it in us, but we still have to be reattuned. I hope that you have shared in some moments that were some sublime moments that have given you a fresh spiritual energy. But you see, there's something that you have to do. The rishi didn't get to in that condition without having overcome himself. Otherwise he wouldn't be able to sit there in that glory and that joy. As I said, perhaps you didn't see it, but perhaps you don't know that he's been fasting for months. Perhaps you don't know that he's been sitting in the snow. Well, he's been overcoming himself. It is not easy to stand there and smile when the whole ground is being taken from under your feet and everything seems to collapse around you and all your hopes have been shattered. It's not easy. Of course not. But that is the victory. And what happens is that you feel then that nobody can take away your joy, because you gain that joy yourself. Doesn't depend upon any circumstances. Then you can really say that you are sannyasin in everyday life. And one doesn't have to wear the clothes of long hair and all that appearance of being special to be spiritual. Has nothing to do with it. Distinguishing oneself from other people, it's just, as I say, in the holistic age, we can't make that distinction between spiritual people and not spiritual people. It belongs to the past. But the real thing, we're learning how to be authentic, and the real thing is, when it comes to the test, how free are you inside? Now the next thing is, which is a criterion of one's spiritual, what we call a spiritual life or spiritual way of looking at life, is always to be aware of the cause and the purpose, the end purpose, or let's say the motivation behind every situation. Now you see people around you caught up in their lives and in a total quandary. Why does this happen to me? And oh, isn't this terrible? And you know, and utterly not seeing in the least what it's all about. Just living from day to day. I call it supermarket mentality. Well, it's very sad. It's low-key. One gets bored and one tries to get oneself entertained to have a little bit of euphoria because life gets too dull. And there's no sense of meaningfulness whatsoever. Whereas the miracle of life is there staring one at the face, but it's only, you have to be able to see deeper than the appearance of things. And then life, as Hazrat Inayat Khan says, becomes so very wonderful, so very exciting. You see the whole, the divine plan. It's like, as he says, the architect witnessing his building. You're participating in the joy of the architect to discover the wonder with which the whole mechanism has been mounted. Well, the first thing is then the cause. Now, if you remember, we looked upon our lives with a kind of panoramic lens, so that all the events were kind of contiguous, that they didn't experience just relive one moment, but we relived the whole span of events. And then, if you remember, we said, when you're able to look upon your life in one take, let's say, like a photograph with a panoramic lens, then you're able to see the interrelationship between events. Like, for example, I see this happened then, and then that happened that 5 years before. I see the connection. Now I see the connection, you see? Like, if you fly in an airplane, you can perhaps see better the lie of the land. You see, if you're in the streets, it's much more difficult to see it. It's the same thing. So every now and again, you take flight. You look upon your life and with this kind of panoramic vision. And you earmark, like, instead of not, you know, being perplexed by what happens, just try and see how it connects up with the past. For example, there was a woman who asked me, why don't my children obey me? And I asked her, did you obey your parents? And she said, no. Well, there you are. It's a law. Very simple. Law of causality. So, why did this happen to me? Aha, I see. 5 years ago, I remember I did that thing then, and now I see. But how is what I'm happening to me, how is it connected within? I can't see, they're not the same people, and so on. Huh? Well, the law works somehow. It's a kind of the law of the computer. It works somehow, like that way. All right, now you've been able to see the cause. But of course, beyond the cause, there's the cause of the cause. So you never finish seeing God. Now for the purpose. Now, we know that with our minds, we cannot, ordinary minds, we cannot see either the cause or the purpose. If we were able to see the cause, it was simply because we flew high. In other words, we brought about a change in our way of thinking, and we did a spiritual practice of meditation, which consists in, well, it consists, if you'd like to know, in lifting yourself in the transcendental dimension of time. Actually, there are two dimensions of time. There's a horizontal and a vertical one. Becoming, it's horizontal, and the other dimension is such that the higher you go, the more eternal time is, and the lower, the more it is spread out in the process of becoming. So the higher you go, the more you're able to see everything with one take. The less, if you're kind of between the two, well, then you can't quite spend the whole of your life with one take. So you're obliged to displace, pan, as they say in cinemas. You displace your consciousness over an area, perhaps not just one event, but still you're not able to see the whole thing as one take. Now, the same thing is true of the purpose. It is only, as Hazrat Inayat Khan says, the purpose is like the horizon. You can never really see it, because as you advance, it recedes, you see something of it, and then you see that there's more of it. So you can never say, no, I see the purpose. And what is certain is that with your ordinary mind attuned to the consciousness in its ordinary focus, you'll never be able to see the purpose. But there is a meditation. And I would say that it is the meditation of the message of Hazrat Inayat Khan. And it's not samadhi. At least it's not alpha samadhi. Getting back into all the things that we did yesterday, getting that very high place where you're not conscious of the physical plane anymore. No. It's being conscious, or let's say entering into the divine planning. Let's say the consciousness, the divine consciousness, the consciousness that God has of the physical plane, not up there. No, it's not samadhi. It is entering into the divine mind as it is working its way, programming things all along the way as things are unfolding in time. And that is that's the whole thinking, that's the whole attunement of Hazrat Inayat Khan. It's meditation in action. It's a totally new way of meditating. Somehow we've got used to always thinking of meditation as an escape from reality. Always, or seeing behind the curtain, or somehow blanking out existence in order to see what's beyond. It's important, in fact, otherwise you wouldn't have been able to reach the encompass the consciousness of the sannyasin or the rishi that we did a minute ago. But now we have to complete our meditation by this most important of all meditations. And maybe the reason why it hasn't been taught so far is because it's kind of difficult. And because, one has to have understood the whole trend of our time, what is happening to the thinking of humanity in our time. You see, the ancients were cause-minded, were always turned towards the past. The cult of the ancestors, Patika Samuppada in Buddhism, it's always samadhi, it's always getting back to the origin. And as we evolve, we become more and more goal-oriented. We're always thinking about the next step ahead. And the fact is that the cause is law, whereas the purpose is freedom. And the ancients didn't have that same sense of freedom as we have. And now we're teaching meditation in the old schools, according to the old schools, because, well, so far it's been very difficult to evolve a modern method of meditation. Oh, it's like teaching the music of Beethoven and Bach. Well, it's wonderful, of course, it's very difficult to beat it. But if you go to school of music, you have to study Stravinsky and Berg and so on, and Stockhausen. So the same thing in our school. Now I think we have to be abreast of the time. That's the reason why I have this hobby of science. It's because we just have to find a way of bringing this whole past of meditation forward, because now it is important to know how meditation works in our lives. Before, maybe it was like getting away from our lives and meditating. Now it has to be built right into our lives. It's a totally new attitude towards meditation.